Did Maharishi personally teach you?
Yes, so what happened then, we went to Bangor in Wales, and we attended a little seminar there. And as you know, there were always lots of flowers around Maharishi. So it was this feeling of connection with nature that was very grounding. And then eventually we went out to Rishikesh with him, which was more sustained.
How long had you been meditating when you went to Rishikesh?
I'm not sure of the exact timings, because it was 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say a month or so.
Uh-huh.
A month, or roughly that.
And when you got to Rishikesh, you went to the ashram. And what was the routine like? What was the experience like in Rishikesh?
It was great. It was very straightforward, very simple. The whole place was very simple. There was nothing fancy about it. You would just wake up, you would then go for breakfast in the morning, a light breakfast. You just socialize a bit with the other members and just get to know each other. And then you would go back for your morning meditation. You go back to your room. We had little chalets, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Each of us had little rooms,
mm-hmm.
which were very simple but adequate. And you would just sit and you would meditate. And then there was lunch, and you'd socialize and chat and stuff. And then you'd meditate in the afternoons. Sometimes Maharishi would have a meeting every so often with you, and you could talk to him about your experiences, and he would help mm-hmm. guide you.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the evening, there was a kind of question and answer session,
mm-hmm.
Which was slightly more formal. That was in a hall. And we would all just be in there, all the students, and Maharishi would come on and talk. And then he would take questions. He would just listen
mm-hmm.
About people's experiences. And that was the sort of thing that happened each day.
Uh-huh. Did you write, how many songs did you write in Rishikesh, do you think?
We wrote quite a few between us. Yeah, we had some good inspiration.
Uh-huh.
And you know, in the times when we weren't meditating, we had our guitars with us.
Right.
So we would do quite a little bit of writing. It was inspirational. It wasn't all about meditation. It was just you felt good. But yeah, there were some very blissful moments. I remember one in particular when I'd been meditating for a little while and I'd got to a really good place. And I remember the feeling was that I was a feather. I felt like I actually was a feather floating over a hot air pipe. And I was just, it was a very nice feeling. And I remember that vividly.
Uh-huh.
And I reported that to Maharishi, and he giggled, "Yes, this is good."
Fantastic.
Such a joy.
Fantastic. See her waters rise. Listen to the pretty sound of music as she
flies. It was a great gift that Maharishi gave us. For me, it came at a time when we were looking for something to kind of stabilize us towards the end of the crazy 60s. And it's a lifelong gift. You know, it's something that you can call on at any time. And I think it's a great thing. I think it's a particularly great thing what David and the Foundation is doing, putting it in schools and allowing kids to experience something that I don't think they otherwise would have had the chance to experience.
and walk out on me. Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. Oh, I get high with a little help from my friends.
Over 40 years ago, we ended up in Rishikesh. And that's where we met. Well, it wasn't where we met. It's where we hung out with Maharishi. We'd met him a few months before in Wales. And since then, sometimes a lot and sometimes a little, I have meditated. And, you know, it's a gift he gave me, was my mantra. That's something I could use and something no one could take away. So it's one of the few things I was ever given that means that much to me. When I first met him, he was in a room, because it was in a university, so we're like in dorm, you know, in a dormitory we're all living. And it's one of those mind-altering moments of your life, because the man was so full of joy, you know, and happiness, and it just blew me away, you know. On my best day, I never felt like he looked. Wow. It was so far out. I want some of that. You know what I mean? Yeah. I was the best thing that could happen.
Where were you before that? What were you?
Well, I never meditated in my life.
But even just your head, your
mind. No, my head was a bit in those last sort of 66, no, 67. Mainly 67 was a bit confused. A lot of things were going on. And anyway, he was one of the people who helped me out of that. Just not that he said, here, right, I'm helping you out. He was helping everybody, but he seriously helped me. Well, the sense of David in his work is brilliant. I mean, he's doing a lot more than I am, and you, and, you know, the foundation. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what it's working for. You know, I mean, the big one for me, of course, is the bringing meditation into schools. And, you know, and he was telling me that, you know, they know from the heads of schools that the violence has gone down. How far out is that, you know?
Particularly when kids are taking guns into school.
I know. Well, you know, it's in, like, hard schools it mainly goes in. That is incredible. You have to support him for that.
You know, you just sort of sit there and you let your mind go, whatever it's going, doesn't matter what you're thinking about, just let it go. And then you just introduce the mantra or the vibration, just to take over from the thought. You don't will it or use your willpower.
If you find yourself thinking, then the moment you realize you've been thinking about things again, then you replace that thought with the mantra again. Sometimes you can go on and you find that you haven't even had the mantra in your mind. It has just been complete blank. But when you reach that point, because it's beyond all experience, then it's down there, and that level is timeless, spaceless. So you could be there for 5 minutes and come out. You don't actually know how long you've been there.
The two things that the Maharishi said this morning were the results for people who meditated and followed this system of meditation. The two things he claimed for it were serenity and energy. Have you found that?
No, well, I mean, I've got the same energy, but I know how to tap it. So.
How do you mean it, Dan?
Well, you know, the energy that I found through doing it, I know damn well I've had it there before. I've only used it on good days, you know, when everything's gone well. Well, with meditation, I find that if it's not too good a day, I can still get the same amount of
Is it true of any day of meditation is equally good? I mean,
yeah, well, the worst days I have on meditation are better than the worst days I had before without it.
Do you find that?
Well, the energy is latent within everybody. It's there anyway. The meditation is just a natural process of the fact of being able to contact that. So by doing it each day, you contact that energy and give yourself a little more. Consequently, you're able to do whatever you normally do, just with a little bit more happiness, maybe.
We like to do a song now, which actually I wrote it in Rishikesh when we were at the ashram with Maharishi. And Maharishi would always say that he wanted everyone to be cosmically conscious. And he'd also say, it's such a joy. Such a joy. And I think this evening's kind of proved that.
Come and be cosmically conscious. Cosmically conscious with me. Come and be cosmically conscious. Cosmically conscious with me. Such a joy.